Hello world, I am Otila here, and in the fifth episode of my series, I will talk about the Crossing the Chasm book, and this is a very interesting book on how to market a high-tech product, and specifically how to take the transition, how to make the transition from early market to mainstream market. And in the beginning, it talked about the challenges of a company when it's trying to get its product adopted. It starts by saying that high-tech companies often must adapt disruptive technologies because like the innovation is like very fast nowadays. A new technology is coming out every day almost, so like these big companies have to stay up to date. And it describes this chart which is a chart about how a high-tech product is being adopted. So there are the innovators who and the early adopters who will be the early adopters who wants to try out the product, and the most difficult jump is between the early majority and the early adopters. And so you should gain market share by going from one group to the next and leveraging the current. So like referencing back to the market before that, like this is a already famous product because a lot of people buy it, and momentum is very important, otherwise competition catches up. But if you can be like the first or like the major player in the market, you can be a monopoly in that segment because the early majority always want to buy from the market leader. And if you are already the market leader, they don't want to adopt anything else. And according to this book, it is important to talk about the definition of the market, like who are in the same market with whom. And for example, you are selling products for doctors, and if you sell a product to a doctor in Singapore and in Paris, they are not in the same market. They are just in the same category, because this book says that people are in the same markets if they can communicate with each other. And so let's talk about this curve. So this curve is how a new product is adopted, and let's talk about each segment in depth. So innovators are technology enthusiasts who just always want to get the latest stuff. Price sensitive, but they are like very focused on that. They want to get the newest stuff, even if it doesn't make any sense or they can't use it. So, for example, augmented reality AR is an example of that at the moment. And the next segment are early adopters. And they are visionaries, probably with funding. So they are the VCs who just want to find the product, and they often dream about a new product or like a future, and they want to go with your firm. But it's difficult to deal with them because they often have just dreams, and it's difficult to make a dream come true. And the next group are the early majority, and they are very practical, and they want to buy from established brands because this makes the most financial sense for them, because they know that like third party softwares or third party apps will be built around the established brand, not the newcomer, and the established brand will have like a long support, so you don't have to buy a new phone in like the next year because of some technical difficulties. The next book, the next group, the early, the late majority, and they don't like technology or complexity. So they like simple products and like whole solutions and services. So for example, software as a service is great for them because they just pay you an amount and you will just supply them with everything. So for example, take a website, and you would design a website for them, and then just host the website, and they would pay you a monthly fee for that. And for the two majorities, you must create low barriers for entry because they don't, none of them like complexities, or they don't like adopting difficulties. While the early adopters and the innovators are prepared a little bit for the bugs and like the technical difficulties, because they know that it's the cost of a new tech product. And the last often ignored group are the laggards, who are skeptics, and they like hate technology, so they are probably with the BlackBerries even now. And they often point out to the difference between the promises of a company and the actual product delivered. So then it says the problem that it's very difficult to make the jump between these adopter groups. So this is how the actual curve looks like. And there are like major gaps between each groups. And the biggest gap are between the early adopters and the early majority. And this gap is the chasm, this book says. Because there are like major differences between these two groups. Because the early adopters want something radically new, like they want just the new technology, and they are prepared for the bugs, while the early majority wants comfortable product improvement. They just want to buy from the established brands. They don't want to debug your product, so they don't want that. And these two groups, their wants are very different. The biggest problem during the transition period is the lack of customer base that can be referenced at the time of making the transition into a new segment. So that's because word of mouth is very important in high-tech industries. So while the early adopters will buy basically any new product, the early majority wants like something established and like already working, and not just like a product in development. And in the second half of the book, it tells a tactic or a strategy on how to cross this chasm. And so let's talk about that. So you must have a niche market that you want to win. And then this it tells like the analogy between the D-Day. So they had a beachhead that they wanted to conquer at all costs. So like the cost doesn't matter, you just want to be established in that market. And this market should be strategic as well, so it will be easy to go down the food chain or like go to other markets. And you want to adopt the big fish small pond approach. So typically, the bigger the better, like the market, but not this time, because you want to be like the de facto, like the basic brand in this segment. So for example, Facebook employed this strategy. Their beachhead was the universities, and they went from each university to the next, and because it was Facebook, like the social, the network effect was very important, and they were able to leverage their current market share and like go to the next and next, and their niche market was the universities, and it was strategic because like there will be always new people in the universities, and like university graduates will like go everywhere in the world, like they will often be very important people, so Facebook will be adopted easily. And the early majority wants to buy from market leaders, so you must establish yourself as a market leader in that segment. And they want to have a good reason to buy your product, so your product is easier to set up, or like it's cheaper, or like it enables them to have higher productivity. And if you have this reason, then you can have a monopoly in the on that reason, because these high tech companies also often have monopolies because of the nature of high tech, like this data, like the market leader and the first to market is usually like the winner, because they can collect the most data, and data is the key. So you should develop a whole product, because it is one of the major buying factors of the early majority. So for example, this was the strategy of Tesla as well. So while the established market automakers would like to sell just the electric car nowadays, like buy our Ford electric F-150, but Tesla understood that they want the whole product, so they built up their charging infrastructure, and it is one of the like major charging infrastructures in the world now. And they also have their own website where they sell their cars, while established automakers use car dealerships, and with car dealerships the car dealer also have to make money, so it's like they charge a little bit of extra money, so they will have problems with that also. And you can have tactical alliances, so for example between Intel and Microsoft, there was this alliance between like the PC manufacturer and like they, I think, loaded the Windows software in all the early, on all the early PCs, and they gained market share by that. And you must position yourself as the market leader, because you want to be the best at your market, and your price should show that. So this is a little bit counterintuitive. So you should price yourself a little bit higher, because like the market leader, so for example Apple also charges like this Apple tax on their products, so it is there, they have a higher price, not lower, and this price tag can be perhaps 30% as well. And you should have a distribution channel that the customer is comfortable with. So for example, if you are a web developer, you are comfortable with the freemium model, where they you can use some of the services for free, but then they want to upsell you on their other products. So they want you to upgrade your products. And then it ended with when you cross the chasm, you can start to make money. And like crossing the chasm is like a battle, so it's like you have to win at all costs. But after that, you can start to make money. And for example, Amazon and Tesla didn't make money for a very long time, because they just wanted to win the battle at all costs. And then it had an interesting appendix about online businesses and how they operate slightly differently than traditional businesses. So this is the 4-gear strategy, and each of these gears is like going like this is like a loop with each of the gears. So first you must acquire traffic so that users visit your website, and then you must engage with the, with these users, so they you want them to like watch your videos or I don't know. And then the third gear is you can monetize their engagement, but it's like a very difficult step, because if you monetize their engagement, so for example Facebook didn't display ads for a long time on their website, and when they saw that they had enough market share, they just turned on the switch and they just made a ton of money, because if you monetize their engagement, this slows down other these other gears. So you should be careful with this. And the fourth and final reason, or like thing, was that you should enlist the faithful. And this is about like in every community there is a small super active group who is like they if you want to pay them money, that would be like a shame for them, because they are just so active, and like this small group will make the majority of your money, so you should be very careful with them. So that was the book. I think it was very interesting from an investing standpoint and also from a business standpoint, like how I would start a high-tech business if I would like if I would have the opportunity. But you can also like look at businesses that is adopting their this strategy, and whether a new business will be able to gain market share. That's a very interesting question by this strategy that every investor must answer. So this was the book. Thank you for coming in, and I'm also available on Twitter, and on I have podcast, so links are in the description. So that's it for today. Bye bye.